Our next speaker will be R.Sarangapani, Head HMI Group Project Engineering C&I Department, NTPC. He has been involved in the engineering of thermal power plants, testing of DCS systems, simulators, and also in commissioning of closed loop controls at various sites. He currently leads the initiative for digitalization of a power plant in NTPC. He has authored papers for national and international conferences, including the ISA POWID division, for which he coined the theme, Empowering Power with Automation. He was instrumental in the preparation of IEC 624-4324, International Standard for Cybersecurity of Industrial Automation Systems, and has contributed to the Indian Manual for Cybersecurity in Power Systems. He's an engineering graduate, C&I, Thapar Institute, Patiala, and postgraduate in computer science from IETE. Please welcome Mr. Sarangapani.
Good morning to all of you. And my previous speakers have set the context of digitalization. So I'll be basically covering you through digitalization aspect of a power plant. And much of this context is applicable to other process industries also, because there are many similarities between power plant and other process industries. So the context will be very clear in the context of a power plant and a process industry. So these things I will be covering: the digital transformation in general, the potential of digital, the key elements. And last year, if you, NTPC presentation was also focused on digitalization, but it was more on the concept part, strategy part. Now, having made a strategy, we are in the execution phase for a digital power plant. So we are making the one power plant as completely digital, which is Simhadri power plant. So I'll be covering the some use cases on those Simhadri power plants, and I will conclude with challenges and some of the concluding statements. Digital enterprise, if you see, a digital transformation can be classified into two parts. One is the digital business model, and other is the operating model. And most of the industries will be first concentrating on the operating model, which means to use digital technologies to improve the bottom line, to improve the profits. And in that, all these aspects cover, because each one of these aspects impact the profit of a company. The digital business model basically is like Amazon had did. They had all the paper books earlier. So when they invented Kindle, they cannibalized themselves. So they went to totally a digital, different model, operating business model itself. So business model will be having a new revenue stream using digital means. So the first step will be, of course, to have a digital operating model and then move on to a digital business model using the outcomes of the later one. Then if you see the potential of digital, the power plant technologies, this slide shows the improvement in the power plant technologies, and each and every technology comes, you get better efficiency. And if you see, just interestingly, some of the technologies between a 500 megawatt subcritical and a supercritical project, in 500 megawatt itself, by increasing the reheat temperature, the efficiency improvement is of the order of less than about 1%, 0.5 to 1%. The same kind of magnitude or quantum is possible through digital. So when you see the potential of digital, without investing any major mechanical modifications, improvements, you can get some amount of efficiency improvement. And that's the potential of digital in this today's context. Because all these developments, they take a lot of time. Like advanced ultra supercritical technology, we are also doing it actually along with BHL and Najika. It takes time. But then digital is one thing where if you invest the correct and you go have a correct strategy, you can realize good amount of efficiency improvement. So that's the power of digital. As I say, mechanical innovations are digital. The future is digital, as my previous speakers have already told. The key elements of digitalization, I'll just revisit. This was covered in last year also. That when you talk of digitalization, the first aspect is data visualization. Having a digital and connecting all systems, the main power of connecting systems is having all the data used for your decision making and one dashboard. So the role-defined dashboards is possible. You don't have to search for data. You don't have to talk to somebody to send an email, and then you see that email and go through. The entire data is available at a click. So that's the first thing of digitalization, data visualization. The second thing, even if having all the data, the decision making may not be possible because it's really a contest of big data. Because in one power plant, almost about 30,000 sensors are there. And going through the history of so many sensors to find out any potential insights is very difficult. So you need a software tool for analytics. And that's why the data analytics is most important in a power plant, where in the data itself, you can find out many things and give you very powerful insights. The third thing, of course, is also an offshoot of data analytics is a digital twin. And when I talk of digital twin, also I'll cover later. So in a digital twin, I am able to simulate many things and try to get a virtual model of the real thing and use that to do my sort of lot of studies before doing an actual modification at the site. And then IoT is, of course, already told. And the IoT, the power, when you map it to a power plant, basically is that already you have a DCS, okay, and with many sensors. But always it's, despite the best signal conditioning, you are not able to predict the failures. The failures happen often. So the most important thing is improve the visibility of the process through additional sensors and connect them to the IoT route. So this is where the IoT, the vibration sensors, which people normally do in the offline condition monitoring. This, if you are able to connect many of the things to in an online in a IoT IoT route, then you are able to get more process visibility and help in the analytics and the insights. Of course, just 1 minute. I'll also cover the digital worker. I'll covering all these things in detail. When you talk of digitalization of a power plant, the closest things which comes is the EPRI. EPRI is basically in the power plant field, and they have come out with a roadmap of i4gen, insight through the integration of information for intelligent generation. And there they have identified these technologies are the most prominent technologies when you apply digitalization to a power plant. And most of our strategy map, which have been evolved for NTPC, is based on this, based on the literature of EPRI. And that's why the context is set for a power plant. It talks of the analytics, advanced control, digital worker, monitoring, and low-cost sensor, which I told. The sensor's cost is also coming down, and with better connectivity like IoT, you are able to get the data which previously was an offline affair. Next, of course, this is the data visualization, which, of course, in any company would have. There will be dashboards, there will be KPIs, which percolate from the top, and the feedback goes from the bottom again to the top. So this part is pretty similar to many other companies. Next, the analytics spectrum. The analytics, the maturity of the analytics, this is taken from a Gartner seminar and Gartner model of analytics, how the analytics gets matured. As you see, as and when you go from descriptive to diagnostics to predictive and then to prescriptive, the human input is coming down, is shrinking. When you have a prescriptive, it will not only identify what is the failure, what is the root cause of the failure, but it can also identify what is to be done at that particular moment of time to avoid any further failures or maybe to minimize the impact of the failure. So this is the kind of analytics maturity which is basically moving in the power plant industry. Next, operations of when you talk of analytics in a power plant, it can be broadly classified into three: operations, maintenance, and business optimization. Operations is having analytics to improve the process, the operating parameters of a station, and of course, with that, helping that to improve the heat rate and reduce the emissions. The second is the maintenance optimization, to have the right balance of availability, cost of maintenance, and the risk using many softwares like RCM, asset management, which basically help you to optimize your cost of maintenance. Are you doing the right type of maintenance? And of course, at the end, improve the availability, reduce your EFOR, equivalent force outage rates. Third is basically more applied to an enterprise level. How can I optimize all my resources? So which you need to load more, where I should stock my coal, and whether I can, how I can source my coal, so how I can optimize my resources, given amount of resources, how best I can address the business problem, given the regulatory challenges. So this is the more on the enterprise level. Next, I am talking about the digital twin. When I talk of digital twin, there are two aspects. One is the dimensional aspect, and one is the thermodynamic aspect. Thermodynamic aspect is basically pure simulation. You have a model, mathematical model, and using the model, doing all kind of what-if simulations to achieve the best combination or the best operating point of a station. So any modification, if you are able to do in a virtual model first, and then apply to the main plant, it has got a lot of benefits. The other thing is a dimensional model. You have got a 3D model, and you not only train in that model, you also link all your asset documentation to that model. So if I click on any of the equipment in a 3D model, I should be able to get every asset information right from the data sheet, the commissioning protocol, the PG test protocol, the spares which are available with the interface with SAP, of course. So what are the spares available at one particular time? How many failures have happened? Is it only one particular part which is failing most? So everything through using a visualization of a 3D. So it helps in many aspects. This is the digital worker. Today, the rounds which were taken in an offline fashion in a power plant, we are trying to automate it with a digital operator rounds, where using a tab, you enter all the data for an offline data. These are two advantages. One, of course, any digital, it improves your workforce productivity. Apart from that, for analytics, it gives all the offline data as a part of the analytics stream. So apart from real-time data and the SAP data, which is a transactional data, I have got the offline data always available for my analytics. So I can do a lot of complex event processing using real-time data and offline data. And if you are able to do at real-time all these things, the predictive capability, the predictive analytics, improves it to a large extent using offline data. The main problem is offline data, it's stored in one place or in a pad of some person. It's entered at a later date, and then the time context is never set. So once you are able to take a data at the local and able to push it to a server, and where you've got analytics, you are able to basically match it together and derive much better predictive analytics. There's quite simple analytics can be created. It need not be very complex. But the time context is most important. And I say that today the AR, VR, these are all very important technologies, and we are also going in this regard. It helps in both ways, availability of ready information at the time where it's required. Second thing, it also helps in knowledge management, where the skilled workers' knowledge is being transferred to across the enterprise. So this is a very important thing where AR and VR can help. Then I come to the IoT. IoT, of course, I not cover much. It's basically collecting all the offline conditioning data which you had through the IoT route, through the IoT gateway, and having it enabled, either to a cloud or an on-premise. So that analytics platform, whether you can have, that is a choice which every company has to make. And these are the choices which a design the end user has to make when you're implementing digital transformation. So, and once it's a cloud, or you can have the availability of expert manpower to diagnose any type of problems, because the real-time problems which is available in the historian of a plant can be merged with the IoT data. So you have now five types of data: IoT, the real-time data of the DCS, the offline data which is captured by the operator rounds, the design data, and the transactional data of the SAP. All together, when you make a creative analytic, it becomes very powerful. Then NTPC has developed a strategy, digital strategy, where without a consultant we have done. We have made a team of engineering, IT, operation services, which represent people from the site, and then the SENPIP, which is the efficiency improvement department. So four departments, they joined together and they created the digital strategy map. Most important thing is we also mapped what is available in NTPC at various corners and various listing, talking to all stakeholders, and then doing a gap analysis. And then finding out what extra is required to make a complete digital solution. And there it was decided that instead of going rolling out an enterprise-wide, we will make a digital plant, which means all the digital technologies in one plant see the effect. Because one aspect is always, I'll come later, the culture aspect. How people are able to embrace it. What are the gaps? What extra we have to do for to get this digital transformation rolling? So one power plant, if we are able to do it, of course, all power plants similar, people are similar, you will be able to do it across the entire enterprise. So that is the strategy with NTPC has started. And these are the tenders. Basically, some of them are internal. I think the RPM part is internal. Centralized monitoring of unit performance indices for a drill down. So connecting all our performance optimization systems at various sites to a central site and trying to do a drill down. So I can compare maybe two projects, how much heat rate, how they are comparing, similar nature, similar lineage. So there I am able to do how this is possible. So one is the APM, that's at performance management, as I told. Through analytics, through RCM, how to derive the best performance of the asset. This is basically maintenance optimization. Another is the APC, where using advanced process control techniques like combustion optimization, which I'll cover later actually, this is a use case, how to improve the operation parameters. Other is the AIM, a digital twin 3D modeling with lifecycle documentation, as I told. Then this I have already covered. IoT is we are going to do with all kind of new structure. Another thing is that the new sensors like corrosion, etc., they come with wireless capability, with IoT capability. So all the new technologies also we can integrate and improve the total predictive analytics. Another is the ARVR, and other in AR actually we are doing, the module is getting developed. Maybe in 1 month it will roll out. That we have developed a module ARVR for turbine maintenance, bearing disassembly and assembly, and how to train the operator. In fact, within 1 month, we'll be inaugurating that. And then advanced monitoring of coal stockyard. So these are the initiatives which we have done. All these are for Simhadri. So all these are on the tender route. Now this I'll cover in detail, advanced process control. In these days, the controls have got a major role, and this data analytics using controls, using the neural networks and many other soft computing techniques, you can derive the best operating point for the station. And here what we have done is, it is basically not an advisory system, it is in closed loop. So whatever this closed loop optimization, they run all the time, 24/7 in the plant, so that there is no need for an operator intervention. And these are the parameter optimization, heat rate, ancillary services. The ramp rate improvement is a very important day because of the renewables coming in. The thermal power plants have to bear the flexibilization part, and they have to give a better ramp rate output. And by better control of the parameters, you can improve the ramp rate. The other is reliability for having better steam temperature control, to reduce the stresses in the plant. And the thing is reducing the minimum stable load. Now this is also coming that because of the renewables, the power plants have to reduce their minimum stable load, which is technically now 55%, but we are trying to reduce it further. And this is, of course, I'll not go into much details because of paucity of time. This, of course, is combustion optimization, where, as I told, that using the data analytics and neural networks, it's able to give and make corrections in the control loops. This is O2 optimization, because the ultimate heat rate in a power plant will be through O2, the optimization of the excess air. And the having the data always available, we can know what is the optimization opportunity available in the plant. So this slide basically shows that you're not optimizing in the point you should be. And there are a lot of scope of optimization here. Suit blowing is also one more area where we have kept this. This is a part of the advanced process control tender. So using a combination of first principles and fuzzy logic, you're able to finally optimize the correct point of suit blowing. So it's all data-driven decision-making. Instead of the operator doing it ritualistically as a routine procedure, this will be done, data will dictate when to do the suit blowing. And that's the power of data. So having data and doing all the data modeling, et cetera, you always get the best efficiency point. Temperature variation, these are some of the variations with load. So as I see, there's a lot of scope of optimization. And this also is there, that model predictive control using data-driven modeling, how I am able to control the process parameters. So this, of course, I'll not go to in much detail. Then the another thing is also, I will also rush through, because the stockyard management is also one more thing, where pain area of all power plants. So because of the lack of visibility of the GCV and volumetric analysis and many things, parameters, most of the places, there's no optimization. As I see that, most of the places is completely manual. And when you do a manual, it's almost like a blind or dead operation. So having the sensors through the IoT route and connecting them, having the power of analytics, you are able to do better stockyard management. So this is also a very important area we picked up for digitalization. And because the losses, if you are able to cut, it directly helps in the bottom line. So coal losses is the most important losses in any power station. Similarly, this is the issues and the way, of course, I've already told. The crux is that we need some automation in this area. And most of the technologies we have kept is the 3D stockpile using laser or radar, both the options are kept. Once you are getting the stockpiling and able to do a volumetric analysis, it helps in actually stocking the piles as per the need of the GCV and able to do a optimization here. Similarly, hotspot detection, this is also one pain area where a lot of losses happen. There's a lot of fire happening in the coal, and we are not able to know, actually. And once with this technology, once we are able to know, and the automatic sprinkling action takes place, a lot of the losses which we are able to reduce this. So this is a program which is under tender now. It is under evaluation. And then it will be awarded and rolled out this year. Similarly, it's just a continuation of the thing. I mean, I'm given a lot of details in this slide itself so that people can, in fact, go through that later on also. I'm just touching the main points. So cameras are there to detect the hotspot detection, will be mounted on the high, and then able to find out the hotspot. Automatic sprinkling. So manual sprinkling, it requires a lot of mechanical modifications here also. The solenoid valves, etc., has to be changed also to account for the automatic sprinkling. So once you have a the aim is to go for a manless operation of stockyard. So there is a lot of reluctance also for the operator to go into that area to do that. So once having a manless and proving it manuals, it will help a lot in the digitalization. This is the after the digitalization, once in a power plant happens, everything will be through dashboards. Everything will be, everybody will have some, some dashboards on his panel, on his tab or whatever device he's got. And all the communications will be through the digital. So some problem is there, I write my comment, what is to be done. So every mode of communication will be, and all the records and all the trails, everything will be available. So everything you do is data driven. Data will be the supreme, and data will guide every activity, not human perceptions or human this thing. That's the most important thing. If you see, this is the typical cycle, day in a life scenario. What will happen when we do a digital plant? So this is the, everything is the AR-based maintenance, as I told, of a leaking control valve. Then these are some of the challenges. Now, when I talk of challenges, the digital maturity model is very much through in the manufacturing sector, in the industry 4, etc. Whereas in the process and the power industry, this has not caught on. So there was a seminar I have recently attended, where the digitalization, one power utility was describing, that they have done a DCS. And they have implemented. So what I will do is, there was a power plant which came for a presentation, and they were discussing about SAP. They have implemented SAP, and that they call it as digitalization. Somebody was saying that I have implemented DCS, I call it digitalization. So there is no benchmark as to what is actually digitalization in a power plant. So that's why the maturity model is very important, that you have some stages of digitalization. Okay, you have done, like Gartner has got a analytics model. They've got an Excel sheet. How much mature is your analytics? And if you can measure it, actually. So that type of model is also required, because the digital word actually has got multiple meanings for many people in the power plant. Second thing is lack of provenness of many solutions, and the typical, the tendering procedure will not help, actually. So we need, and the provenness is not something which is there in your application. It may be for some other application, so you have to be very flexible enough for that. Then applications not open to integrations, like vibration monitoring. I was knowing that it was, they have this, you know, the diagnostics, machine diagnostics. And the machine diagnostic results, I cannot use in my analytics, general purpose analytics. Like typical misalignment. If you had concluded that machine diagnostics had concluded misalignment, that value is not available. It is only available in that software. So this maturity has to there that every software has to give it results to the to some other software, some other analytics platform. Otherwise, we will not be able to see every information at one place. That is the aim. The other thing is user buy-in for investment. So today also there are many people who will say that today also I am able to optimize, I am able to run my plant in the most, why the need actually. So that is one very important aspect. Other is culture and mindset, visibility to work in work areas. So once having a digital, as I told, the single version of truth, which is a popular statement today, that may not go well many people. So this is also one important area which is to be kept in mind when you go for a digital transformation. Then aversion to change is of course always there. And the last aspect is cyber security. So this is a very important aspect which cannot be overlooked. As the DCS has progressed with connecting with IT, this aspect also has to be seen and overcome. Then, as I told, as I conclude, just in the last 1 minute, digital is a new normal and we do not have a luxury of time. We have to do it fast. And because the more you do it fast, you come to know what are the mistakes and how you can calibrate the digital transformation. So if you don't start it, you will never be able to have that, to reach that stage. And of course, quick wins, scalable, this is also quite work. And I conclude with this quote, the best way to predict the future is to create it yourself. Thank you. Thank you so much for the fine discussion.